I'm going to share the last message in the series. I've shared three messages so far. The first one is called Right Standing. The second one, Right Husband. Some of you think I need to hear that one, but it's not, may not be what you think. The third message, which I shared, was Right Perfection. And today I'm going to share on Right Lamb. Right Lamb. Let me show you a scripture. Exodus 29, verse 38 says, "Now this is what you shall offer on the altar. Two lambs of the first year. Day by day, continually." Continually. "One lamb you shall offer in the morning, and the other lamb you shall offer at twilight." Now this is something Israel had to do, the nation of Israel, every day. Two lambs for their sins. One in the morning, one at twilight. So I have a question for you. Have you offered your lamb today? Now obviously this is a prophetic picture, but we need to talk about that, because I think people are still offering lambs. By the way, the one in the at twilight was for any sins you had committed during the day, and the one in the morning was for any sins you committed after the sun went down, which for some of you in your past life would have been a lot of sins. Right? I'm right there with you. But we don't have to offer a lamb, but do we still do this? Do we still think that it's something we need to do? I remember when I was a little boy being told that if you didn't confess all your sins, they wouldn't be forgiven. You had to confess all your sins, or one of them might slip through, not get forgiven. So I started carrying a notepad. When I'd sin, I'd write it down, because I didn't want to forget one, you know, and then go to hell, you know. So, I mean, that's what I thought as a little boy, you know. You go to hell if you don't, you know, so better write that down. And then I remember thinking, what if my parents find this? I mean, this is like a signed confession, you know. So I came up with a code. And I would say other words that meant different sins. Like, I thought the trees were pretty today. Real pretty. But think about how we have to confess our sins to be forgiven for our eternal destination. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't confess our sins. Obviously, the Bible talks about it. But is it for the cleansing of the soul that we confess our sins, as Hebrews says? Or is it that if one slips through, it won't be forgiven? I mean, do you really think that your eternal destination is dependent upon your memory? Because if it is, you're in trouble. Because some of you can't even remember what you did yesterday. And then I remember as a little boy, when I heard this great prayer, Wednesday night prayer meetings. Did you ever go to Wednesday night, go to grow up church? Wednesday night prayer meetings. And I heard this lady pray, "And Lord, forgive us for all the sins we can't remember." Praise the Lord. It's the catch-all prayer. I didn't even know there was one. Throw my notebook away. And then I remember the prayer from this older deacon, deep voice, you know, "And Lord, forgive us for all of our sins of omission and commission." Had to use a long O even on the word commission, you know, so it would rhyme with omission. Omission and commission. Do you know what that actually means? It means forgive me for the sins I didn't mean to commit, and forgive me for the sins I did mean to commit. I mean, I thought about it, and I decided to do it anyway. Commission. So is that why we're forgiven? Are we forgiven because we cover all the bases, or are we forgiven because He covered all the bases? It's because of grace and grace period. Now, it's through faith. We have to believe. You have a choice. You have a will. You can choose. Every person decides where he or she is going to spend eternity. God doesn't decide that for you. You do. So I want to talk about the lamb, and is he the right lamb? So here are three things. Number one, the lamb was provided. The lamb was provided. This is important to understand that you didn't provide your own lamb. That God actually provided the lamb. And it goes back even farther than you might think it goes back. I could take it all the way back to the garden when Adam and Eve sinned and they tried to cover their own sin, and God came, and the way he covered their sin was with the shedding of blood. All the way back to the Garden of Eden. But let me go back just 2,000 years before Christ to Abraham. Remember, God told him to sacrifice his son, and of course he stopped him. But let me show you the scripture, Genesis 22, verse 7. But Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. And then he said, look, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb? Where's the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide. This is where we get the word, one of his names, Jehovah Jireh. God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Okay, God will provide the lamb. Here's the only problem. He did not provide the lamb that day. He didn't even provide a lamb that day. He provided a ram of such mature growth that his horns were caught in a thicket. That's not a lamb. And many people don't even know how old Isaac was at the time. He was at least 20 years old. He was between 20 and 37. His mother died at 37, right after this. But some theologians believe that Isaac was 33. But we don't know for sure. But he's on Mount Moriah, which is where the Temple Mount is, which David purchased in 1,000 years later, and then they built the temple on it. And then Jesus actually cleansed that temple. It's pretty amazing. And you can stand on the Temple Mount and see where Jesus was crucified, the hill where he was crucified. So God provides a lamb. God will provide. Can I tell you something? Whatever you need, no matter what it is, that's the answer right there. If you have a physical need, if you have a spiritual need, if you have a financial need, if you have a health need, if you have a marital need, if you have a family need, whatever it is, God will provide. A week ago Friday, my closest, best friend from childhood passed away. So I've been mourning for a little over a week now. His name was Roy Westbrook. I met him when I was 12 years old in the sixth grade. Roy was the most popular kid in school. I remember us talking about how long we've known each other. When we were 32, we said, you realize we've known each other 20 years now. And we talked about how when our parents would say, I've known that guy 20 years. We thought, how old are you? And then at 42, we would call and talk, and we'd known each other 30 years. And then at 52, and then this year I'm 62, and I talked to him this fall, and of course I've talked to him since. But we said, we've now known each other 50 years. 50 years. But Roy, most popular kid in school, president of our class when we graduated, never bent morally when all the stuff was going on in the 70s and it was so popular to try marijuana and things like that. He never did any of that. You couldn't make him do anything like that. And even though I went in that lifestyle, he remained my friend. But I remember him reaching out to me in the sixth grade, and it changed my life because the popular crowd was the crowd I thought I could never be a part of. And here was the most popular guy in school. We were talking with his wife last night, laughing and crying and remembering. You know, because we've known each other so long, we knew them while they were dating, they knew us while we were dating, and they got married the same summer we did, 1980. 1980, if you don't know, hottest summer on record in Texas. And after we got married a few months in August, we decided to go camping. In a tent. We couldn't afford anything else, you know. And we were talking with his wife, Lisa, last night, Debbie and I, and what happened was Rory worked as a welder at that time, and he was used to the heat. He worked inside 100 and something degrees, but it was over that, you know, where he worked, inside this metal building, and so he slept like a log. Debbie and I and Lisa, we couldn't sleep. Mosquito, we're East Texas, so mosquitoes are the state bird of Texas, if you don't know. And so they're all over the place. So we can't sleep, it's still 90-something probably. So we had borrowed a boat from my dad, and it had a leak in it. But we went out to the middle of the lake because the mosquitoes won't go out to the middle of the lake. Some of you might know that, so now you learned something. And so we're out in the middle of the lake, but one, we had to keep our feet on the floor so as the boat filled up with water, then I could start it up about every hour and drive it, take the plug out, you know, drain. I don't know why I told you that. It doesn't have anything to do with the message. The point is that here's one of our closest friends that's gone to be with the Lord, and we're talking with her, with his wife last night, and I thought about this. God will provide. How's she going to make it through now? God will provide. Whatever you need, God will provide. Here's number two. The lamb was pure. The lamb was provided, and the lamb was pure. Exodus 12, verse 5 says, your lamb shall be without blemish. Your lamb shall be without blemish. Now, in the English, this is two words, and you could actually argue that it's three, with and out, or a conjunction, or conjoined together, you know. But without blemish, in the Hebrew, which the Old Testament is written in Hebrew, it's one word. It appears 91 times in Scripture. And it's one word. You know what it means? 100% pure. Without blemish, without defect, without spot, without wrinkle, 100% pure. That's Old Testament verse. Let me show you New Testament verse. 1 Peter 1:19. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot. In the Greek, New Testament written in Greek, these two words, without blemish, are one word also. It appears 8 times in the New Testament. Again, it means 100% pure. But I want to show you another place it appears because I want to prove to you that it's by grace, not works, that we're saved. Because there's another verse that preachers use a lot, but they misuse it. Some. Not all, but some. It's Ephesians chapter 5, verse 27. It says that he, Jesus, might present her, the church, to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Same Greek word that's used referring to Christ. How can you be without blemish? How can you be 100% pure? Only by grace, not by works. None of us will get there by works. None of us can be 100%. Think about that. And preachers use this verse and say, Jesus is coming back for a bride that's without spot or wrinkle. We need to get holy. Listen, the only way you can get holy is by accepting Jesus. That's it. That's the only way we can do it. Now, this is actually Passover weekend, Resurrection weekend, because he, you know, was raised from the dead, but he was also crucified. So it's Passover. Comes from Exodus 12, very first Passover ever. And God tells Moses what to do so that the angel, the destroyer, will pass over their houses. That's where we get the word Passover. Passover. Those two words go together, okay? That's where we get it. But I just want you to think about this for a moment, okay? Because of the culture of the day, only the men went to the meeting. Ladies were not allowed. And the men had to go home and tell the women what Moses said. Now, I'm just wondering if in some homes it didn't go that well. I'm just wondering, okay? I'm just wondering, you know, if one lady might have said, so what'd he say this time? Well, we have to kill a lamb. Another lamb. That's 16 this month. What is it with Moses and lambs? You know, he needs professional help. Well, there's something else too. Okay, what? Well, we have to put the blood on the door. On my door? You think you're gonna put blood on my door? We just painted that door last month, sir. And red is not in our color scheme. Okay, so why did I bring that up? Because they got saved the same way we get saved. They had to believe in the blood of the Lamb. See, we have this concept that people got saved in the Old Testament by works and grace in the New. No, even all the way back to Genesis 6, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. First time the word grace is in the Bible. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Even though he was a righteous man, he still needed grace. It's all through Scripture. So the lamb was provided, the lamb was pure. Here's number three, the lamb was perfect. Okay, so even if you're pure, I've still got you because none of you are perfect. You know, I love to kid with Debbie. Debbie's pure, she's not perfect. You're not perfect. You still know how much I love to say that. You're not perfect. But she's pure. She was pure when I met her. She's still pure. But none of us are perfect. But the lamb had to be perfect. I'm going to show it to you. Leviticus 22, verse 21. And whoever offers a sacrifice of a peace offering to the Lord to fulfill his vow or free will offering from the cattle or the sheep, watch, it must be perfect to be accepted. There shall be no defect in it. By the way, same word as without blemish in Exodus 12, same Hebrew word here. It shall be perfect. So every year before Passover, once a year they'd go to Jerusalem, which is on the day that Jesus was crucified. But every year the man would be watching the lambs that were born to find one without blemish, without defect, perfect. But I don't know if you ever thought about this. He's on the way to Jerusalem. And by the way, if the lamb dies on the way, at Jerusalem there were people who were making money. They would sell lambs, but they mark up the price, obviously, you know. So he's watching this lamb. But here's what I want to know. What were his thoughts on the way to Jerusalem? Were any of his thoughts like this? You know, I hope the rabbi doesn't ask about my synagogue attendance. As you know, I was, you know, building my business this year, and I didn't attend as much as I should have. I hope he doesn't ask about my attendance. You think he had that thought? Or maybe he thought, I hope he doesn't ask about my Torah reading, because I really didn't read the Bible as much as I should have this last year, you know, being so busy and all. So I hope he doesn't ask that. Do you think he had that thought? No. All of his thoughts or about his lamb. Will my lamb be accepted? Because if his lamb was accepted, then he was accepted. It had nothing to do with his works or his church attendance or his Bible reading. It was just about his lamb. Do you realize that the world examined our lamb and said this. The world said this. I find no fault in him. No defect. He's perfect. Even the world said that. You know who else examined our lamb? The Father. Remember when he's getting baptized? What'd the Father say? This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Here's what he was saying. He's perfect. He's accepted. Please hear me. It's so easy to get saved. It's so easy. You just put your faith in the Lamb. You just trust in the Lamb. On your own, you can never get there. Only with the Lamb. He's the right Lamb. I was trying to lead this guy to the Lord one time, and he was this great big guy. Big guy. Big, tough guy, you know. And he was crying. He just said, I'm just too bad. I'm just too bad, preacher. You don't understand. I'm just too bad. I'm too bad. I'm too bad to be saved. I'm just too bad. You just don't understand, preacher. I'm just too bad. And I don't know if you know, but when you're trying to lead someone to the Lord, there's a spiritual battle. You've really got to press through because the enemy right there at the end is just doing everything he can to keep the person from that one step of faith, you know? So after about 15 minutes of him telling me, you know, I'm just too bad. I just had this thought, and I knew it was from the Lord. I said to him, you know, I've been thinking about this. I think you are too bad to be saved. And he goes like this, what? I said, yeah, I've been thinking about it. I think you're too bad to be saved. And he said, well, what about all that stuff about Jesus dying on the cross for my sins? And I said to him, well, do you think that's enough? And this big smile comes on his face. And he says, yes, I do. I said, now you can be saved. And now you can be saved.